Listening Library presents The Excalibur Curse by Kiersten White, read for you by Elizabeth Knowelden. To Kimberly, may you never come out of your shell. Chapter 1. Once, not so long ago, Guinevere had ridden surrounded by armed soldiers and marvelled at her power. Now she rode surrounded by armed soldiers and marvelled at her smallness. She tried to hold on to both thoughts at once, her power and her smallness, each a comfort in its own way. She was only one girl, after all, in a world full of them. Unfortunately, the armed soldiers around her at this precise moment were enemies of Arthur, Picts led by their king, Necton, the sorceress Morgana, Arthur's half-sister, and his nephew, Mordred, the betrayer. Guinevere had thought herself triumphant in sealing the city just before they arrived, but they had never been coming for the city. They had been coming for her. It was enough to drive her mad, but she was too tired for it. Guinevere half suspected the reason they had not dismounted and rested for the past 12 hours was to ensure that her nether regions were so painful that she would not try to escape. She had lost feeling in her toes, and her spine ached from sitting as straight as possible so as not to lean back against Mordred. The least they could have done is give her a horse instead of forcing her to ride with him. She had no idea how many leagues they had covered, but it was certainly more than she had ever travelled in a single stretch. Their pace was hurried without being frantic. The Picts were practiced soldiers. They were not going to risk their horses' health, but their horses had been trained to do exactly this. Camelot falling farther and farther behind them as they rode into the night worried Guinevere less than the fact that they were galloping in the opposite direction of her goal. Merlin's cave would take her so much longer to reach now. She had planned on walking straight there, figuring out a way to free him from the Lady of the Lake's trap and demanding answers about who she was, so she could finally know. If she could only know that, everything else would make sense. Would be easier. She was certain of it. She focused on the cave, because that was less painful to think about than Camelot, about how she had left it, about who she had left. The image of Lancelot on her knees, behind the magical barrier they had created to keep armies out, but Lancelot in, lingered in Guinevere's mind like a wound. Guinevere knew what it meant to be denied crucial information, to be manipulated into a course of action without the freedom to decide. And she had done exactly that to Lancelot, not telling her brave knight until it was too late that Lancelot would be inside the city's shield and Guinevere outside it. It had been cruel and unfair, and a betrayal of the trust Lancelot had always given her. So she tried her best to not think about it. Fortunately, between the enemy soldiers and Mordred, and this wretched, endless ride, adding to the already long walk between her and Merlin's cave, she had an abundance of distractions. At last, with dawn stretching pink and terrible across the sky, Mordred called out, "The horses need to rest." It was the first time he had spoken the entire journey. The first time he had spoken since he had arrived at Camelot, begged her not to lose faith in him, and then announced he had successfully kidnapped the queen. Other than his chest at her back and his arms around her holding the reins, their only interaction was when he periodically passed her a canteen to drink from. As soon as Mordred declared the horses needed to rest, word spread along the travelling party. Guinevere estimated there were 200 or 300 soldiers. She slipped a hand into her pouch. All this long journey, she had tied knot after knot in her mind, from the most innocuous to the most vicious. It was time to choose. A shudder rippled through her. She knew what she had to do. She would need her iron thread, and she would need blood, and it would be the worst knot she had ever tied. Worse than the protection she had placed in the river above Camelot that would kill anyone who ventured past it with intent to do her harm. Worse even than what she had done to Sir Bors, reaching into his mind and manipulating his memories. Perhaps not worse than what she had done to King Mark, destroying his mind but leaving his body, but certainly an evil enough magic that it would haunt her the rest of her days. She was going to tie a death knot, loop it around herself so that any living creature that touched her would immediately die. And then she would walk out of the camp. It would not matter if they followed her all the way to Merlin's cave, because no one could touch her. The knot would mean she could not take a horse, but after 12 hours on one, that was almost a blessing. She had to get away from Mordred first, though. Someone would touch her, doubtless, before they believed her threat. But it could not be Mordred. Not Mordred. It had to be someone whose name and face she did not know. A soldier sacrificed to a conflict Guinevere had not started. A person, both small and infinite, ended because Guinevere valued herself more. How did Arthur do this? How did he make these decisions? Her stomach churned, gnawing at its own emptiness. She squeezed her eyes closed. She could do this. She would do this. Mordred's fingers circled her wrist, his grip gentle but insistent as he pulled her hand out of the pouch. He detached the pouch from her belt and tossed it to a tall, elegantly cloaked woman. His mother, Morgana. She caught it neatly and tucked it into her own bag. Guinevere did not know whether she was about to cry out of frustration and disappointment or relief. Mordred had taken the choice from her. No one would die at her hand today. She would figure out another means of escape, hopefully one with a less desperate cost. Feeling blurry with exhaustion, she watched as a camp appeared around them with practiced efficiency. Soldiers laughed and called to each other while they worked. Then everyone stilled as King Necton rode past them. He slowed, fixing eyes that had possibly once been wide and kind on Guinevere. Whatever they had been was hidden beneath bushy eyebrows and a permanent glower. He would have been intimidating even without the fur mantle he wore around his shoulders that quivered with black moths. Guinevere knew that each moth carried a bit of the Dark Queen inside it. A constant reminder of whom King Necton was working with, or for. It was hard to say which with the Dark Queen. One moth rode on his earlobe like an ornament. Necton bent his head toward it, his gaze turning distant and unfocused, before snapping back to Guinevere with an almost physical force. She sighed with relief when he turned to Mordred. It was not only the presence of King Necton, but also the knowledge that anything he did or said was not him alone. The Picked King and the Dark Queen were each a formidable enemy on their own, and now Guinevere had to contend with them both. Necton said something in his language. Guinevere did not understand, but she did not need to. The way he spoke made it clear that Mordred was in trouble. If she were in higher spirits, she would tease him. As it was, she was grateful that King Necton continued riding past. his head bent once more toward the whispering wings of his passengers and the queen they were part of. Mordred dismounted, then held up his hands to help Guinevere down. She deliberately threw.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.